But I want to say good morning to everybody who is excited to be here in the house of God. Every single week that we get to come and be here, it's a privilege. It's a privilege to do life with every person here. It's a privilege to be able to hear the word of God, to be able to sing. It's a great, great thing, a great opportunity. Let's appreciate it. Let's enjoy it. And I can keep talking, or we can start. Amen.
Washing Oh, and stars, they wept. The morning sun was dead. The Savior of the world was fallen. His body on the cross, his blood poured out for us. The weight of every curse upon. He gave as heaven looked away. The Son of God was laid in darkness. A battle in the grave, a war on death was waged. The power of hell forever broke. The ground began to shake. The storm was
the Lamb is overcome. voice with the sound of worship, the sound of every voice just lifted up, declaring the praises of God, that we serve a God who is forever risen. He conquered sin. He conquered death. He defeated the grave. He took our sin, our shame, our iniquity, our sickness. He has overcome every fear. He has overcome every obstacle. He is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And so this morning, let us come with a fresh sound of worship, with a fresh song of praise, declaring the praises of our God. Amen?
Amen.
So right now, we're going to fill this place with the sound of worship. Every voice just singing out the praises of God. You have overcome, you have overcome. Oh, death, where is your sting? Oh, where is your sting? Our King is overcome. He is overcome. Jesus, Jesus, you have overcome. We sing our praise. We sing our
hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, the Lamb is overcome, we sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, the Lamb is overcome, we sing hallelujah. Hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, the Lamb is overcome.
We sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, we sing hallelujah, the Lamb is overcome. You've victory in you. There is victory.
Pick up my cross. I just felt during worship today, this verse, Psalms 23:5 was laid on my heart, and it's kind of funny because it's the one verse in the whole scripture, the whole passage that I'm like, this is such a funny verse. And I just felt like the Holy Spirit wanted me to share it. It's, you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil and my cup runs over. And I just felt like this morning that the Holy Spirit, God wants to just let you know that He's prepared blessing. He's prepared something for you this morning. He's prepared something for you for this life. And that even though you're eating and you're supposed to eat in front of your enemy, how terrifying is that? That's a terrifying thought. You're like gonna eat in front of your enemy. That's not cool. I'd probably like kind of eat. But God says that He's prepared this table before you. And I just feel like this morning that we need to trust in God because He's got it. Even though we can see the enemy, we can see adversity before us, we can see our situation that looks hopeless, He says, eat. Just eat. Just trust me. I got this. And I just felt like this morning that's just some of us, that's what we need to do. There's situations in our lives that are going kind of crazy, and God just says, eat. Eat up.
Jesus. God, we thank you so much for that word. Lord, this morning we thank you that even in the presence of our enemies, God, you prepare a table. God, we thank you this morning that we know this, that our God is for us. God, that if you're with us and you're for us, who can be against us? And so, Lord, this morning, we just pray that our hearts and affections would be set on you, that we would recognize, God, we don't have to fear what's going on around us. We don't have to fret those things, God, but we can fully trust in you and your blessing, God. We can fully trust in the reality that you are with us, you are for us, and you are leading us, God. We thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, let's give the Lord a shout this morning.
Check. Good morning. Welcome to Joy. How are you guys doing this morning? That was delayed and weak. How are you guys doing this morning? It's a little better, a little better. Cool. Well, good morning. We're so glad that you're with us here at Joy this morning. If it is your first time or you're new to the Joy family, we would love the opportunity to get you connected. And the best way you can do that is by going right through these doors. There's a table out there called our Connections Booth. There's some people out there who would love to meet you, get the chance to meet you, meet your family, let you know a little bit more about who we are here at Joy Christian Fellowship. If you don't have a chance to do that, right in front of you, there's a card that says welcome. If you don't mind picking that up, filling it out, you can drop it in the offering bucket, or you can leave it at the Connections Booth on your way out. We also want to let you know about an awesome opportunity that happens every single week, and those are our Connect Groups. And Connect Groups are awesome. They are our weekly Bible studies, and there is sure to be one perfect for you. So make sure you check those out at our Connect Wall in the foyer or at joychristianfellowship.com. We've got a couple exciting things coming up, the first of which is our work day, our all-church work day, which is coming up on Saturday, March 19th, prepping our building for Easter, which we're super excited about. So we'd love to see all of you guys come down, help make our church look beautiful, and help us with some of the projects that are going on. That's from 9 to noon on the 19th. And then also, Easter is coming up. Isn't that exciting? Easter is coming up on the 27th of March, and we have not one, but two services happening on Easter Sunday at both 9 and 11 a.m. So we want to make sure that you guys are out for that. There is going to be an Easter egg hunt for the kids, giveaways, photo booth, all the Easter fun stuff. So make sure that you come and bring somebody with you. We have lots of flyers out at the info booth, or as you head out, the ushers are going to have some today to pick up. Make sure you're inviting someone to bring with you to Easter. A lot of people say that they'll come to church if only someone invited them. So pick up some flyers, be inviting people to Easter. And then also please remember to be bringing candy for all of our kids for Easter. We want to, and for the parents that we know you steal out of your kids' Easter buckets, and for the people who don't have kids to like beg your kids for candy, you know, that type of thing. Make sure you're bringing in the candy for all the kids to bless our kids and our community. Also, we want to let you know next week we are starting a brand new series, which is going to be great. It's called The Weekend, and it's our pre-Easter Easter series, so make sure that you invite a friend for that starting next Sunday, the 13th, I believe it is, and it's going to be a great time. And now we're going to welcome up Pastor Kim for a special announcement.
Awesome. Woohoo! How many know what time of year it is? It's activate time for our gals. Woohoo! We are 6 weeks out from our awesome ladies conference, and I'm so excited. Pastor Judy Jaquith from Puebla, Mexico is going to be with us. We have lots of churches coming to join us. But you know who I want to see there? You. Every lady. No guys, please, dressed as ladies, just all gals. But you know, husbands, if I can tell you, boyfriends, if you want to get your girl here, buy her this. It's $25 if you pay before April, I think it's 5th. $30 after that, that $5 extra would get you a coffee somewhere, so save it and get invested in this. We're going to have an awesome time. You know, I was thinking, how many of you are already kind of getting your gardens prepared or at least thinking about it? Getting the soil ready. My husband's got garden things growing on our kitchen windowsill. Pretty exciting. Now there's 1,000 ants there too, but that's exciting. That's all part of gardening, you know? It's awesome. But I just want to encourage you, we're going to come this weekend. Our theme is grow to what do what? Get our hearts really ready for the seed of God's word and to really grow. How many have areas in your life that you go, I want to get better at, I want to grow? Well, this weekend is for you. And so put it on your calendar. It is April 15th and 16th. It's a Friday night, a Saturday morning, and we get done around lunchtime. You have dinner provided. You have a wonderful brunch the next day. Great time with gals. There's no place you'd rather be April 15th and 16th than here at Activate for all the ladies. So come, and I have a special giveaway. Someone that is planning on coming, but you have a friend that you want to give a free admission to this. I signed it. It says free friend. And so who has got a person they want to bring that wants to run up right now and grab this free? Woo, there she is. All right. All right, Jenny. So this is a free one for your friend. Do you have a name already who they are?
Beth.
Yeah. Okay. So we'll start praying for Beth. Awesome. So next week, I'm going to do another one of those, but this is so good. Come yourself, please come, but bring somebody with you. Bring a coworker, bring a family member, bring a friend, bring a stranger on the street that looks like they would like to come. But come, it's going to be a great weekend. I'm so excited, and we got a lot of great things planned for you. So, awesome. Tyler, are you coming?
Good morning, church. How's it going?
Good.
It's a good Sunday, good worship. Excited to be here. Are you guys excited? Hopefully. If you weren't, you wouldn't be here, right? If you guys want to turn with me to Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 and 6, for those that have been attending Joy for quite some time, you'd remember years and years ago we'd say this portion of scripture like clockwork every Sunday. So for those that have been, you already know where I'm going with this. But the first two verses, it says, "Trust in the Lord with all of your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all of your ways acknowledge him and he shall direct your path." You know what I love about this portion of scripture? You know, so often we like to try to find the gray zone, right? Kind of the fence line, the line of how far can I get before going too far? What, you know, that kind of thing. We like to play games sometimes. But this portion of scripture kind of eliminates any excuse to be in a gray zone. Because it says it's trust in the Lord with what? All of your heart and lean not on your own understanding in all of your ways acknowledge him and he shall direct your paths. No gray zone here. Very clear. God likes to make things very clear. Here is my plan. Here are other plans. You choose my plan and it's going to work out for you. If you choose another plan, it's going to go south quickly, right? Now, in all of our lives, we have marriage, we have relationships, we have finances, we have occupations. That's all inclusive in the all of what we're to trust God with, right? Are you following me? Are you walking along? Now, I'm giving the tithe offering, right? So we're going to direct it towards finances. It's really easy when we're in church in the presence of God as the worship's going and there's that thick synth that makes you feel all warm inside, right? It's like, oh, Jesus, I trust you with everything. And then your paycheck comes and all the bills show up and you start thinking, maybe I don't trust the Lord with all of my heart. Or maybe you're in marriage and all of a sudden a disturbance comes and you begin to argue. And then all of a sudden that whole all thing becomes a little questionable. But I want to encourage you guys, as we are preparing to give, Let's challenge ourselves. I don't want to look for the gray zone, but I want to really do what God's calling me to do and be who God's calling me to be. So I'm going to step out and really trust with all that I am, every part of my life, all right? So when you're bringing out your paycheck, you're pulling out your pay, what's that, PayPal? Yeah, the PayPal or Push Pay. What's PayPal? It's another thing. Well, Push Pay, don't go to PayPal because you'll be paying the wrong thing, all right? But go to Push Pay and don't do it out of compulsion or out of a pressure, but say, God, I really do trust you, so I'm going to put my money where my mouth is and says, I'm gonna live this out every day, okay? So go ahead, ushers, do what you do. Alrighty, let's pray for the offering. Father God, we thank you for the opportunity to be able to gather together in your house and worship you. And Lord, we do choose as a congregation, Lord, to trust you with all that we are, God. We eliminate any gray zone and we say every part of our lives we surrender to you, including our finances, knowing that you are a good God that does what you'll say you'll do. So we trust you, we worship you, we love you. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen. Amen. All right. Children, you are dismissed to your classes. We'll welcome up our pastor, Pastor Steve, to bring the message.
And that was pretty cool, Tyler. Like, bring down the funk, bring the thunder, bring the excitement. Don't collapse up there. Okay. All right. We're all here today. Some of us are here. Some of us are just here. How many of you are here today? We're here. Yeah, super. Well, you're looking very, very handsome and beautiful, all you ladies. Yeah, and Danny, of course, you're always the most handsome. Danny's like the most interesting man in the world, you know. He's the most popular guest at parties he doesn't even attend. all right, well, I've been thinking about this message. Because this is in between series. We just finished up the series on the happiest place on earth of the family, the happiest place on earth. Or it can be hell on earth. It all depends. Then we're going to be starting looking at our Easter and culminating with, of course, Resurrection Sunday. So I had what's called a free message where I just preach something that's like on my heart. And I've had a phrase that's been running in my mind called, it's hard to stop a train. That was an advertisement for a certain type of a heater called trains, T-R-A-N-E. And it was a cute play on words because we know that trains are powerful instruments to move people or move freight. And so the train heater manufacturer, they put out that statement, it's hard to stop a train. And that phrase has been in my mind, it's hard to stop a train. Trains. We're going to Luckenbach, Texas, to Waylon and Willie and the boys. This successful life I'm living's got us feuding like the Hatfields and McCoys. We're going to Lou Berry's train songs. Blue eyes crying in the rain. Looking back, Texas, ain't nobody feeling no pain. All the country people are going, oh, you're stroking my heart. Denny said, I'm glad you complimented me because I hate that. Denny has brain damage. Train songs. How many of you ever heard like train songs? Folsom City Blues and Johnny Cash. That lonely whistle blows. Well, Johnny, my boy, Johnny's like collective. Everyone, you know, Johnny's like just like owned by Joy Christian Fellowship. How you know he's like common property here. Anyway, he's going to be coming back, and he'll land here Friday this time. We've been enjoying communicating with him while he's, and I'm talking about trains, and I'm going somewhere with this message, just so you don't think I'm random. But Cambodia is 15 hours ahead. So Johnny will call us, and it'll be morning for us, and I say, Johnny, tell us how our day's going to go, since you've already spent it. He said, Dad, Mom, it's going to be good today. Okay, good. So now that we know, because he's already lived it. So this Friday, he's going to be home. But on his return trip, he has a 16-hour layover in Shanghai. And now, before you go, opportunity, see? See, if you're Poe and you're broke and you just sit in the airport, bummer. You know what I'm saying? Three minutes, you know. But he's going to get off and get on the world's fastest train. And it's even faster than my BMW going up I-5. Those like super trains, what are they, 200-300 miles an hour? And so he's going to be going in and doing a tour of the city of Shanghai, and we hope he's not Shanghai'd in the process. Trains. I remember from being just a little kid here in Southern Oregon, and when we lived in Phoenix, we lived very close, in fact, right next to the train tracks. And I remember in the middle of the night as a little kid just hearing that, as, you know, the lumber cars, you know, Medford was a major lumber center at that time, just loaded up, and I just still, even where I live, I can hear the trains every once in a while, and, you know, it'll be late at night, and I just go, oh, yeah, because I remember as a little kid to feel the chill of just the night air and hearing the whistle blow and seeing trains, and my buddies and I used to play around the train tracks. I've had a lot of dangerous hobbies, playing with propane tanks, which is my current one, playing on train tracks, you know, and doing things that you don't want your kids to do. I've done most of them, put pennies on the train track to see how they get decorated when the train runs over them, stuff like that. But trains, big part of my life, just seeing, you know, a single locomotive train and then seeing dual locomotives and sometimes up to three or more locomotives chugging a train. Then when I moved up to Ashland, I began to be aware of the fact that the trains that were headed south had to climb the Siskiyou Mountain Pass. Now what happened was in 2008, they stopped the run that went up over the Siskiyous, and all of our freight that shipped out of Rogue Valley has to go through Eugene before it hits the north-south lines. I'm going to read to you something about the Siskiyou line. Major repairs to the Siskiyou rail line are on schedule so that the line will see its first trains as early as the first week of November. Freight service on the historic line, which first opened in December 1887, and runs 95 miles from Ashland to Weed, stopped in 2008. The Siskiyou Summit Railroad Revitalization Project is repairing and revitalizing a 65-mile section of the 296-mile stretch of the Short Line Railroad, including rail, tunnels, ties, and bridges, as well as upgrading its freight car capacity to handle the 286,000-pound industry standard for rail cars. Currently, timber companies and other Southern Oregon manufacturers must ship by freight rail north to Eugene to meet the Union Pacific line into the southwest. Of course, funny things, you know, about playing in railroad yards is, you know, you'd say to a kid, I saw UP on the side of a railroad car. No, you didn't. Yeah, I did. I saw UP. Union Pacific. You know, I saw UP. That's abbreviation. My wife loves alliteration. I do that every week. Just, I saw UP on a railroad car. And so if you've seen railroad cars, how many have seen railroad cars? Now they're heavily graffitied in many cases, you know. Some of your relatives from Southern California are sending you email. Anyway. A train is hard to move, but when going, is very hard to stop. It's hard to stop a train. Now, I think it was Denzel Washington did a movie recently about the runaway train, really kind of a cool movie. And we've all had those runaway trail cars or locomotives, movies, how hard it is to stop. It's also hard to get them started. Multiple locomotives allow a train to just do a one-to-one ratio. Let's say that one locomotive can pull 20 fully loaded freight cars. Then you put two on there, it can maybe pull 40, or if there's a tiny bit of loss, maybe 35. Three, you can have a much longer train. But watch this, it's a one-to-one ratio. God has made a feature that acts like an unstoppable train but is more powerful than linking locomotives. How many of you ever just sat and watched a train? I heard the story one time of a pastor that his board and the guys on staff started thinking he was possibly having a bad relationship with someone. Because every day around 2 o'clock, he'd leave the office just quietly, secretively, and drive off alone. And no one knew where he went. Finally, one deacon said, I'm going to trail him. And so he trailed him, and he found the pastor parking in a secluded spot and overlooking trains. And no one showed up to meet him there in this trysting place. And so the deacon finally knocked on the window. Oh, well, hi, Deacon Jones. What's up? He said, well, we were nervous thinking maybe you're having a relationship. Why are you doing this every afternoon? You're coming up here and you're watching a train. He said, you know, I've been in the ministry all these years, and I love to see something move under its own power that I don't have to push. And that's why he would watch the train, because it just motors. And so being a lover of trains, and now, of course, they've got what are called EMUs, which are electric multiple units, which is how a lot of electric trains are, that each car has its own motor. It's electric, and so that allows them to really get screaming fast early. They use those in a lot of commuter trains in big cities, et cetera. But I've always been fascinated with the power and muscle of trains and how much freight they can haul and how cheap it is to ship via railroad car as opposed to other ways to ship it. But then when I thought about God's plan to bring us into a multiplied effectiveness when we link locomotives. Now, do you know where I'm going to go when I talk about church? People don't understand that God is just amazing power, and that we as individuals, we are made in the image and likeness of God, and that when people link together, which we call unity, I'm not just saying Christians, I'm saying when people link together, their effectiveness can get multiplied beyond one-to-one ratio. The power of collaboration, the power of unity. I want to hopefully motivate every person here to, one, want to unite your energy with God's energy, because he's like the ultimate big locomotive. You are going to look good pulling your train when you got that big locomotive screaming out in front of you.
Me and my man, we got our own thing going down. Yeah, we got our hustle. Yeah.
Yeah, that's great. That's the dope world, right? I'm just leading myself. A lot of people want to be their own man, their own woman. No one's going to get in my way. No one's telling me what to do. I'm not getting in unity with anybody. You know, I'm captain of my own ship, admiral of my own destiny. You're a loser. Sorry. You're going to need to collaborate with somebody. When you hook your train to God's train, when you hook your train and your locomotive, what the power that you bring in agreement with God, I want to tell you something. That's why God could tell Joshua, no enemy is going to stand before you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, I'm going to be with you. I like unity. I like saying yes as often as I can every day. when someone comes up to me with vision and drive and dream and you can sense it's God, I like to say yes and amen. When God says, Schmelzer, I want you to change something, and I know it's destructive in my life, I like to say yes as often as I can. When my wife has a good plan, and I'm sitting there like most men, just wanting to change the channel, and she comes up with a better thing, like maybe we ought to clean the garage before the rats pack away all we have. And I like to say yes. Say the word yes. Say unity. Say positivity. Say power. Now say the word lonely. All by myself. One is the loneliest number. One is the lone. Our culture has so glorified one. And what do we have? Man, I see all kinds of people with signs asking for me to give them food and money. And no one's telling them what to do. I'd rather hook up in some unity with God's thoughts, with God's salvation, with marriage the way God intends it, and see what kind of power, what happens when you really get a train pulling the weight, but with multiplied effectiveness greater than any train that's been made on the earth. Let's look at this illustration in Deuteronomy chapter 32, looking at verses 29 through 30. Now, if you get a sickness, like a gastrointestinal sickness, like Jake read me this hilarious Amazon review. What were those gummy bears? Caribou sugar-free? Hairbo. If you want to laugh and have self-induced diarrhea by laughter, read Amazon review. This lady writes how she ate the sugar-free and just flatulence, her bowels exploded, and she just went nuts. So if you're eating those and I see you take off out of here, that's cool, as long as you get what we're trying to push today, which is there's power in unity. So in case you've eaten some Haribo sugar-free gummy bears and you have to bolt out of here like a bat out of hell, we'll understand. Because the rest of us are going to read that review and just die laughing. I thought I was going to split a rib hearing him read what the review on that was. And it wasn't just one person. It was multiple people. They said it was lava from hell. And and the most brutal review was a gal said, I'm a girl. I'm not a guy. I'm a girl that's writing this. It's the kind of things that men's retreats are full of, just that kind of humor. It's so inappropriate for a pulpit. I don't know why I'm bringing it up. I want you to get the punchline in case there's a crisis that happens in your intestines or something. That we're talking about unity, the power of unity. Deuteronomy 32, verses 29 and following. Oh, that they were wise, that they understood this, that they would consider their latter end. How could one chase 1,000 and two put 10,000 to flight? Wow, let's do some algebra here. One person chasing 1,000 enemies is awfully impressive. When I'm all alone, all by myself, that's great. But the older I get in life, the less I want to go it alone. I'd like to get a little consensus on everything I do. You can't be a Christian by yourself, and you can't be married all by yourself. It's going to take a bit of cooperation. We together as the body of Christ, it's amazing how powerful every local church is. Every one of them filled with a cluster of God. Even when I'm naughty and God is spanking me and as a leader, I'm not the smartest or wisest or the sharpest instrument in the drawer, I know one thing, that in the midst, a whole bunch of you are really innocent, at least during the time I'm not. And there's power in the cluster. That when we join together and we say we are the body of Christ and we love Jesus, not only at Joy, but at First Baptist Church, at Harvest Baptist, at Table Rock Fellowship, and every life-giving church in this area. God says, they're my people. Their unity brings a blessing. There's power when we say, wow, with God, I can put 1,000 to flight. But he goes on and he says, listen, and two put 10,000 to flight. So basically, if you were to put under the first equation, if you were to put away 10,000 people, you'd need 10 people. That's still impressive. But that's not what God said. He said, if you had known my presence, my power, and what it means to get united behind my way of thinking, you would have been able to realize one could alone could put 1,000 to flight. That's miraculous. But two in unity can put 10,000. Exponentially, it just jumps up. By what? 100? 900% increase from 1,000 to 10,000? Do the math. That's a 900% increase by adding one other person in unity. That's why everything with God, he said, in the mouth of two or three witnesses, I want everything established. If two or three of you gather together as concerning anything that they ask, it will be done for them of God. That's why that when you raise your family right, you know, you have a man and a woman who come together to do a great thing under a code of ethics, and we get on the same page. Say same page. Say random. Random and same page don't work together. Random means, oh, love is going to work it out. Love never works it out. Truth does. When you love people, you walk in truth. When you have a God who loves you, he said, you will be knowing the truth, and the truth will set you free. And when you unite under truth, especially with people of like mind, there's an unstoppable characteristic. It's hard to stop a train. It's hard to stop God's people when we're in unity and we just hunker down and we lock and load and say, hey, we're doing the God thing. We do this every day. We wake up breathing God in. We welcome the work of the Holy Spirit. We're not stopped. We're not moved because alone, I'm pretty bad. Alone, come bring your 10,000. But I got homies that are about 15 minutes away and we're coming as a unit. And if two of us can drive out 10,000, what's going to happen if 50 of us show up with an attitude? That's why across our nation, the number one goal of the Antichrist spirit is to get everybody fighting. Well, you're not black. I know I'm not black. Darn it, I've been white all my life, and I tan every summer, and it goes away in the fall. I am so bored stiff of all this crappy, moronic racism bullcrap. Look in a mirror and declare yourself beautiful. Black is beautiful, but stinking pale white from Seattle is beautiful too. This time of year, people from Portland and Seattle, they come through and they're like, ah, what's wrong with them? Do they have leprosy? No, they're just up there. They haven't seen the sun. It shows up in April. I go, ah, a UFO, an unidentified flying object. What is it? I want to tell you something. I love people. There's only one race. It's called the human race. Out of one blood, he made all the nations of the earth. Kim and I got married in Oakland in a highly integrated. So with my black brothers, I said, that proves we all came from a brother because it said from one blood he's made all. That's black people's nickname for each other. Hey, blood, what's up? And the Bible said from one blood he's made all the nations.
How dare a white guy talk like that?
This white guy does not give a rip who I insult. I insult white people all the time. I might as well insult blacks, browns, pinks, whatever. When are we going to just be honest and just say, hey, deal with people as people? I don't go to somebody that's from Mexico and go, I've met some of your people and they're okay. Can I tell you something? There's a lot of white people I don't even like. They suck. I don't go, Denny. Well, Denny's just a half a Mexican in a white guy's world trying to get by, he tells me. Yeah, there's a white guy. Yeah, Pete Miller. Am I preaching yet? I'm talking about unity. I'm talking about the demonic strategy to divide us. Man, I'm so glad we don't have white people food. You can only go to Eat-N-Out and Der Wiener Schnitzel. What about when you want Chinese? What about when you want barbecue and soul food? What about when you're jonesing for like chili verde? Why is it that in food we can be so tolerant, but then we're all nervous?
I'm just so embarrassed about being a white guy.
I'm just embarrassed about being fat. I don't care what color I am. I'm a fat guy that's getting old. Yeah. I love with being with people that are ethnically different than me. But you know what I keep finding when I do that? That they're not. They love Jesus. They long for their babies. They love their grandchildren too. That's how Vietnamese people are. That's how Chinese people are. That's how Finnish people are. That's how black people are in Africa and the United States. That's how Mexican people are. That's how El Salvadoran people are. That's how people in Tierra del Fuego, Argentina are. That's the world we were made to not be all divided up. Satan wants racial disunity. Satan wants us to be all divided about whether you're a Republican, Democrat, Independent. He wants you to suspect everybody. He wants you to confess that America has gone to hell in a handbasket. Let me just say this. There's a lot of kick left in us. This kingdom of God will not be stopped. It's hard to stop a train. Everything that Jesus said would be coming to pass is coming to pass, including the fact that the knowledge that the glory of God would cover the earth as, and the knowledge of the glory of God would cover the earth as the waters cover the sea. I want to tell you something. You can't stop Christianity. It's thriving and moving ahead in Saudi Arabia. It's moving ahead in United Arab Emirates. Some of the largest desire for online Bibles is coming from Arab nations. You cannot stop the train. Get united with something that's unstoppable. Don't be blowing yourself up, you and your man, walking down the street, man, all strung out and hyper. Don't have to worry about weight loss. Hello? Come on now. Let's be humorous a little bit. Does anybody notice there's a drug problem in America? Let's lampoon it a little bit, and then let's get people out of it. Well, we don't want to talk about drugs. We don't want to talk about racism. We don't want to talk about our feelings. We don't want to talk about our own dysfunction. We want to just, hey, we're in the cure place. Currency has been paid to pay the bills for all of our needs. Oh, that they are wise, God says. Oh, if they could understand what would happen down if they'd locked and loaded with people of like mind. They got their marriages all set up, called together, good to go. You know, call together is such a waste of time if you're only planning on being married for 2 years. But if you're planning on being married for 80 or 60, it's a very small investment. And two put 10,000 to flight unless their rock had sold them and the Lord had surrendered them. Matthew 18, words of Jesus, verses 19 through 20. Again, I say to you that if two of you agree on earth concerning anything that they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, I am there in the midst of them. Wow. That's a promise and a threat. Don't be jumping up in someone's unity. Don't be trying to hurt someone's marriage. When he loves her and she loves him and they're doing their best to serve God and they care and they've got Jesus up in the midst, it's hard to stop a train. When I see strong unity and I see a God thing, I just back off, let it roll. Don't be jumping in there. What happens You know, the greatest spot that these kind of things can happen are when you have roommates or you're married or you have a family. Wow. A lot of people say, well, what happened with the Schmelzers? What happened? What, your kids are, they're crazy for Jesus. And that was because Kim and I, we hunkered down when we had nothing. Now, why do I do this? Because if you've ever seen alpine skiers, you know what I'm talking about? Ski jumpers. Have you ever noticed that most athletes, when they want power, they hunker down and they get united? This is not a non-threatening thing. Riley, right up front. You're next to Riley. Riley Amon and Riley. Riley. This is the Riley row. Riley row right there. Okay. You want to take me on? Want to see if I can spring out of here? Nail you? Hurt you bad like a linebacker? 30 years ago, I'd have been able to do that. Now I'd fall down like I did at the men's meeting the other night. I fell for you guys. Yeah. This is why, never underestimate a church plant or an entrepreneur. You know? They do crazy things and it works. I was talking to a friend of mine when Denny and Jan were starting up their thing, and I'm going, I don't know if they're crazy or not. And my friend Tim Bolton said, he said, do never underestimate the power of determined, focused, united entrepreneurs. Well, Denny, you and Jan, moving ahead. Unity makes a difference. This is just kind of like a feel-good kind of message, or feel bad if you've been really in disunity. There's power. Kim and I, just a couple of kids, going to start a church with no money to speak of. But what did we have? We had unity. We knew what we wanted from God. We knew what we wanted to see in the local church. Can I tell you something that I see at Joy? The dream's coming to pass. What we came into unity about is coming to pass. A whole lot of people are building their marriages right. They're building their families right. They're loving Jesus. They're witnessing to the lost. They're merciful. They're tender. And so you just get together with your sweetie. People come up and say, I don't think that much of you or your marriage. I've got really good words for them. Some of them are Christian. Like, the Lord bless thee and keep thee far from me before you get hurt. I love to see a husband and wife walk in here. They're holding hands and they're going, you know what? I love her. I love him. Well, you know, you get the chippers and the grousers, and everybody's willing to pick on your marriage or willing to pick on a church or willing to pick on a government. But who's willing to get united concerning a great matter and see how strong the train rolls when it's chugging down that line? That's what happened. Kim and I, we knew what we wanted in our children. We never made it an option. Well, we're hoping if we have four kids that we'll have half or maybe three quarters serve the Lord. We just said, no, Satan, again, you know the exit. I want four out of four. And their friends, I want 8 out of 8, 100 out of 100. When I lose any game, I'm broken. I don't care if it's a chess game, if it's an electronic game, and especially the game of evangelism and the game of life and the game of pastoring. I can't stand to lose. I never want to grow accustomed to losing. Because see, when you grow accustomed to losing, you break unity with your real values. Well, I believe this, but you know, you just kind of settle. Really? Why? Why settle? You're not dead yet. Don't settle. Keep going to the high ground. Jesus said, when you agree as touching anything in my name, I'm there in the midst of them. In other words, there's a quorum for getting business done. Now, there's some qualifiers here. You have to be in agreement as God's will. That's why, you know, John said, this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if he hears us, we know that we have the petitions that we desired of him. So part of this whole thing is as James said in James 1, he said, if any of you lack wisdom, that doesn't mean you're just a general dummy. It means you lack specific bits of wisdom about specific needs in your life. He said, if anyone lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives freely and doesn't upbraid. He won't rebuke you for seeking wisdom. But to stand with that wisdom and not be double-minded. Don't waffle. There are times I don't want to talk to God because I know we're going to talk about a thing and I know where he's going with this. Have any of you ever boycotted God? Okay, get your hands up if you've done it. Okay, look at the rest of them. They're liars or they're not Christians yet. We've all had times we didn't want to talk to Dad. How are you? Okay. Want to talk? No, not particularly. If you lack wisdom, get the mind of the Lord, lock and load, get united behind it. Especially if it's something that relates to your marriage and relates to you, relates to your family. You can't be all persuaded of God one way and then just totally abandon it and go the other way overnight. James said, a person that does that is unstable in all their ways. They're like a wind. They're like a wave tossed by the wind. Let that man not suppose he'll receive anything from God. God really likes people that put their hand to the plow. They plow a straight course. They do what he's instructed them, and they bring others into unity. So that's what the leadership's job at Joy is to help bring people into unity. Oh, unity on your opinion? No, unity on the Word of God. Because Scripture will make you wise unto salvation. What's a good eldership and good deacons and good leadership in a church? We're just trying to help you know what the Word of God says and help you to say yes easier. That's why we have like the rack where we stretch you and with the people with the whips in the back room. We just want to bring you into an agreement. In Luke chapter 11, verse 17, which I believe is the Magna Carta, there's no chapter better in the Bible for a prayer ministry than Luke 11. It's got the Lord's Prayer, and it goes to where Jesus is describing what's up. When the Pharisees came up and said, "You're casting out demons by the power of Beelzebub," that is some of the richest understanding you're going to find in the Bible about what's really up in your life. Let me just summarize it. In your life, you're either becoming a punk of the devil or you're smacking him down. That if we were to invite Lucifer in here to explain it, he'd say, "Punk, yes or no?" That's all he needs to know. And a lot of Christians, he has no respect for them because though they have the name of Jesus, they never utilize it with any authority. They always assume they're going to get ran over, so he provides the running over. They always think that they're the one that's going to get a disease, so he provides a disease. They always feel they're one that's going to lose their marriage, so their marriages are lost. There's got to come a time when you have an attitude and do what Jesus said. Jesus said that here's what happens. A strong man holds a house till another one comes in and grabs him and takes the armor in which he trusted and spoils the house. And that's what Jesus did. He came into a locked up house under the control of the demonic. And he was casting out demons. He was setting prisoners free. He was getting the religious very uncomfortable. He was getting the unrighteous very comfortable as they became born again. And he said this, "I'm the dude that comes in and kicks open the door and starts setting people free." And so he goes on to explain, listen, the reason it's not Beelzebub. That was one of my cousins from Alabama, Beelzebub. That's kind of humor, kind of. He said, if Beelzebub was casting out demons, he goes this, "But he, knowing their thoughts, said to them, 'Every kingdom divided against itself is brought to desolation. And a house divided against a house falls.'" We're seeing that all over America. Broken homes, broken homes, broken homes. What happened? There was no code of ethics. We got married on lust. We got married on convenience. We got married because he was the only guy that ever showed interest. How about locking and loading, saying, God, I'd rather be waiting to get married, never marrying anybody till I'm 70 rather than settle. God, it's your problem to manufacture a guy and send him my way. Lord, it's your responsibility to bring me from wherever a woman who's of my people. That doesn't mean racial. It means spiritual persuasion about how you're going to live life, do your worship, raise your kids, save money, pay for your house, on and on and on. I think we need people who are called together. I believe you should not join Joy because you like it here. Go further. Be assigned to Joy or be assigned somewhere, but don't be a floater. You still qualify for a double-minded man. You will be unstable in all your ways. I like assigned seating. I like knowing that God wanted me to come to Medford. God specifically told me when I didn't have faith for this building, the Holy Spirit spoke to me and he said, this is way above your faith level, but I'm your father. And right now that other pastor is trying to sell you that other building. And I want you to get two of your friends to go after that building because I have a plan for you on Taylor Rock Road. And then when it looked like it fell to pieces and this church was going to be sold to the Jehovah's Witness, the Holy Spirit said, skip the Jehovah's Witnesses. Go tell your elders what I tell you now. I told them 3 months in advance. I said, God said he's going to throw the JWs off the train, that we're going to get that building. So we're in a building that I didn't have faith for, but I knew one thing. You lock and load with the word of God unless you're so smart you can see around corners. And so fearfully and trembling, we, the eldership, 95 of us in a church buying this barn. Our total overhead was $500 a month for our rent, our utilities, and a little office I had next door. Oh, it was like heaven. I had a staff of me, a total unity. I was by myself and loving it. I find that when there's one or more people, there's conflict with me. Overhead, 500. We come in this place. God opens the door miraculously. First electric bill, $1,400. I was talking to management. God, are you the devil too? We didn't actually say that, but for humor, let's take it. Lord said, it's going to challenge, it's going to take your faith to go cross rivers, take land, see the promises of God. How many of you know a lot of Christians would like everything to not require faith, trust, guidance? So what do you do? There are times that Kim will ask me, are you okay? I said, well, no, I'm not okay, but it's not you. There's some weird, I wake up and I want to be asleep. I'm asleep, I want to wake up. I feel like I need to itch, but don't know where to scratch. How many of you ever had that when God is starting to try to speak to you and guide you? Seem like nothing fits. You get a call from a friend, I don't want to talk to them. Do you want to talk to yourself? No, not me, especially not myself. At times, Kim has asked me, said, are you okay, honey? I said, God's doing something. And all that we need is a death. Is for God to help me to die to myself, and it'll be better on the other side. How many of you know that that's the key to Christian growth? Surrender yourself to the Lord. Come into unity. And so many times when God's done really bad things, like the afternoon I'm sitting with Jerry and Jamie, we're just having a nice elder to pastor chat. I think it was over Chinese food. Very expensive Chinese food that day. They're talking about La Paz, and all of a sudden the Holy Spirit said, tell them they're the ones. We wept. Jerry and Jamie were great elders here. We're either going to store everybody and just squelch the move of God, or we're going to lose people that we sow. And after that train was running, you have those second thoughts. Oh, should I have done it? I'll tell you what, La Paz, Mexico, Baja is very thankful that we stayed with the unity behind what God said. When we sent Jake and Bethany north by the word of the Lord, it's like so many of you are like, oh, this hurts. And it did, and it does. But see, you can't have your cake and eat it too. Many people are trying to straddle life without making moral decisions to come into unity. And they're wondering why their house is divided and it can't stand. How many of you know we could go a lot of weeks on this series? That's why my messages go like 7 hours at a time, because we just do it. Jesus in John chapter 15, I'm the vine, you're the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit, for without me you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, is cast out as a branch and is withered, and they gather them and throw them into the fire, and they are burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, you will ask what you desire, and it shall be done for you. What is this? We mock the Eastern religions because they talk about oneness with the universe. And one day I was talking to the Lord in prayer, and I said, yeah, grew up in Ashton, and I heard all that, the Maharishis and being one with the universe, and the Holy Spirit stopped me. Said even in their deception, they were reaching out for something, because when you come into agreement with me, you come into agreement with the universe. How many of you know the universe is God's property, and the universe will all be one at some point? No longer will I mock someone from a transcendental or meditation or Hare Krishna trying to chant the names of God. I'm going to just tell them there's a name you need to chant. It's called the name of Jesus. And replete with Jesus comes a whole document you need to build your life around. And that's how the universe will be one. Not by singing songs like Imagine. Not by marching with tambourines going ching, ching. All we are saying, ching, ching, ching. Give peace a chant, ching, ching. No, there's going to be no peace on the earth, the Bible said, until the peace, the Prince of Peace is acknowledged as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. So there are cutesy things, and there's actual things that you can do. You want to be one with the universe? Get one with God. Because that's where the universe is going. That's the direction. Psalm 86, verse 11, teach me your way, O Lord, I will walk in your truth. Unite my heart to fear your name. This was back when I was a kid in the 60s. You know, everybody was talking, dude, you know, I hitchhiked from New Jersey, man. I'm just trying to get my head together. Wow, man. Any of you still trying to get your head together? Now, Dakota and Sarah, they look like the hippie girls I grew up with, but I think their heads together now. Yeah. We got to have a holdout, man. People are like, oh, those poor girls are embarrassed. No, they love it. Trust me. Yeah. They're millennials. It's different than you old people. Okay. How many of you remember, like, people trying to get their head together? Well, this is exactly the problem with people today. They don't have their head together. Husband and wife don't know what they're trying to build. And, you know, he's wanting to get to retirement, and she's wanting to raise drug-free kids. And, you know, sometimes you just have to say, what do we want? Let's list them all. From retirement to goals to how we live to how we vacation to how we eat. It's not all deep-fried foods all the time, and she's eating tofu. That doesn't work. Unite my heart, David said. Unite my heart to fear your name. We see in Psalm 133 how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It's like precious oil upon the head. You can read that later. Isaiah chapter 65, verse 8, thus says the Lord, as the new wine is found in the cluster. That word cluster is bachad, which means basically a giant unity. How many of you ever had a cluster of grapes? It's one cluster, but it's got many, many parts. We see that same theme in the Shema, the famous rallying point of the Jews in Deuteronomy chapter 64. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Now, what it says really is, Hear, O Israel, Jehovah, our Eloheinu, or our Elohim, the Lord is one. Literally, it's saying, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our gods is one God. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength. Why? Because, see, God is three persons. God, we worship. Now, who do you worship? We worship three persons. We believe in Father. We believe in the Word or the Son. We believe in the Holy Spirit. So they're a plural unity. They're an echad. They're a cluster of unity within the Godhead. That's why it said, and God said, let us make man in our own image. Let us. I don't believe the angels manufactured men. We were made directly by the hand of God. God said, let us, let our plural unity bring an effect to make man in our image. It's very important that everything in the Bible speaks of unity. Ecclesiastes chapter 4, we won't go on into it. Two are better than one because they have a good reward for their labor. But if they fall, one will lift up his companion. But woe to him who is alone when he falls, for he has no one to help him. Again, if two lie down together, I remind my wife of this all the time. Again, if two lie down together, they will keep warm. She wants me to leave the thermostat up. I said, no, honey, because if it's too warm, you won't crawl over to my side of the bed, or you won't welcome me over. So the Bible says, the Bible, honey, the Bible says, if two lie down together, they will keep warm. Doesn't mention a thermostat, so we need, but how can one be warm alone? Turn up the thermostat's the answer now. Though one may be overpowered by another, two can withstand him, and a threefold cord is not quickly broken. Okay, stand up with me very quickly. Quickly! I've just had a marvelous time myself. Has this message been okay? Come on now, let's give it, yeah. Okay. For you people that are on the stream, did you see that spontaneous, overwhelming applause? Who am I preaching to and who am I preaching for? I'm preaching to you and I'm preaching for you. That's what good counsel is. It's like, okay, I already practice unity all over the place. I try to get good counsel when it comes on raising my garden. I try to get good counsel and come into unity on how to get my car repaired, what tires to buy, how often to rotate them, et cetera, et cetera. At my age, I don't want to be stellar, all alone, and stand out in the crowd. I just want to get in on it. Okay? And so what I'm saying is, if I'd never taught this today, I still would be living these things. I'm doing it because you guys watch. How many of you say, I'm going to give some energy to starting to put unity into every relationship I have? So if you're dealing with the lost, how can you be united with the lost? One, you can deny your faith and become a sinner, or you can pull them in by the strength of your personality and say, let's do the God thing together. Hello? Raising your kids. Guys, humble yourself. Talk to your wife. If she's frustrated about your parenting, trust me, it's probably worth taking a look at. Get in unity. Parent those kids with a plan. Parent them with a creed. And look at the long haul. Unity, unity, unity. Locomotive on the train track will only go 1-to-1 ratio. Unity will exponentially make you an unstoppable army. How many of you want that unstoppable nature of unity in your life with God? First thing you can do, the Bible tells us that sins and mankind's very nature from the time of Adam on, that we've all sinned except for one, that was Jesus. But we've all sinned and fallen short of God's expectation. If we sin one time, then we are disqualified from ever being good enough to go to heaven. The Bible tells us that sin in its nature stains our garment. There's only one solvent that can ever take away sin stains out of your life, and that's the blood of Jesus. There's only one name given under heaven whereby men must be saved. A lot of people offer some realm of hope. But the Bible said there's only one form of hope, and that's the name of Jesus. Putting your faith in what Jesus has done for you, because God the Father loved the world so much. He loved us that we're out of compliance. We were sinners. We were doing our own thing. Some people were doing more violent things. Some people were doing more sexual things. Some people were doing more greed things. Some people were doing more isolation and selfishness things. It doesn't matter. We all ate the fruit and we died. And you must be born of God to be in the kingdom of God. The number one unity thing that you can do is to come into agreement and say, God, you say I'm a sinner and I want to be your child. I want to come to hook my car and the locomotive that I am. I no longer want to try to go up over hills and find that I'm always insufficient. But I believe if I can hook onto you, God, the strongest locomotive, the strongest power source in the world, I can be free of sin. I can be free of bondage. I can be free of hopelessness. And then I will be able to make agreements at my work, in my marriage, in my relationships, in where you guide me to go to church. God, I don't want to make up my own life anymore. God, I need you to see around corners. You knew me when I was being formed. And only you can give me the plan for my life that's going to be right. Week after week, people step down here and they say, I want to join God. You don't have to know everything about God. You just have to know He's here and He wants you. And that He will give you instructions. I want every one of you that are here saying, man, I need help. I need God. Step on out. Come on down. Bring a friend. Don't be embarrassed to ask a friend, hey, dude, you know, we're all jacked up. Is this your day to join God? How many of you are happy about the day you joined God and God joined you? Come on down right now if you're here, all of you that are here, and you say, man, I want new life. I want to serve Jesus. I want to hook myself to Father God to pull me into freedom, into life. Those of you who are watching on the live stream, you may be at home, you may be in a hotel, you may not even be feeling well, but I will tell you this, that hope and life comes through Jesus. This greatest power on the earth wants to be a part of getting you on the right track, headed for the right station. God bless you. Last call for those that would like to receive Jesus. How many of you say, I've received Jesus, but I want this power of unity in my life. Could we get those hands up? How many of you would go say vigorously, I need that. I need unity. Employers need unity on their job. Churches thrive. I want to tell you something. One of the greatest strengths of joy, there's so much crazy unity here. We even get criticized for it. One of the cute names of all you guys, you're joy bots. I'll tell you what. You're not controlled by me because I'm a nerd. You are controlled by the Word and by the Holy Spirit. If that's what a joy bot is, sign me up, man. I'll re-up my subscription right now. There's unity because we want to do the God thing. I want to be Jesus's little joy bot, just loving Him. Because I'll tell you what, He has never steered me wrong. Hallelujah. Both hands, we're going to pray. I'm really, really going to pray now. Pray this with me. Dear Father, you are awesome. I've tried to be the little train that could. That worked okay on small hills. Not so much on the real steep ones. Your plan for my life is not just little hills. There's some steep ones. Dear Lord, I believe that it's hard to stop a train. I come into unity with your unstoppable power. I unite with people in my family, people in my Connect group, people in the house of God here, Christians all over our city, Christians all over our county, Christians all over our state, our nation, the world. I am not a rebel any longer. I want in on it. I want to see how crazy from 1 to 1,000, 2 to 10,000, what would happen when millions of us are lined up declaring the kingdom of God, showing what heaven on earth is to look like. Move in me, Lord. Move in us, oh God. Unite my heart. Put my head together, Lord, to line up with your word, with your spirit. I pray this, dear Father, in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I want to pray for all of you. As we're praying, the Holy Spirit says to me that some of you have been really punched out by the devil. And he's lied to you and he said, you're not worth, no one wants to ever unite with you. That makes me mad. I want to tell you something. The devil sucks. And that's his good spot. That's his good parts. Is he sucks. We can work down from there. And I want to tell you something. If you can say the name of Jesus, the power of heaven is waiting to rush into your account. Lord, I speak a prayer over this congregation. They are sons and daughters of the living God. All of us failed. All of us fell short. And even as I walk with you, and as we attempt to walk with you, we still don't look exactly like you. But your name is a precious name. It's a holy name, and you've given your name to your kids. To open up that pantry and call out for the needs, whether they're financial or emotional, relational. And I pray, Lord, that that power of unity, that lie, I break you now in the name of Jesus. I speak to each Christian here, to each person who longs for God. As you long, as you reach out to God, he reaches out to you. Draw near to God and he will draw near to you. And I speak and I prophesy blessing into your life. I speak and I declare that there's not a mountain, there is not a track that you can't go over and go over it and carry the payload to wherever God has called you. We speak blessing on the families here. We speak blessing on the unity here. We speak blessing on our nation. We are blessers. We are offspring of Abraham. Bless your people, Lord. I'm going to say in Jesus' name, I feel so much energy here. Some of you might need to just do whatever you need to do and sit down and say, get it, get it, get it. I got to get it, God. I feel like Father's on the table and he's got legal pads and he's got contracts. And he's saying, I just want to talk to people that want to do some business with me. I've got the money, I've got the power, I've got the resource, I've got the life. I just need people that are willing to let me be strong in their behalf. God is here to do business. Some of you are going to just have this wake up tonight. If you get waking up at night, trust me, go get a cup of water and, of course, peanut butter and jelly. That's necessary at night. Let your dad talk to you. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to have prayer here for the sick and anything you need agreement for. Elders and I will be down here to pray for you. God bless you. Keep praying for the people in the hospital. Carol Aguirre, Rick, Arquette. God bless you guys. Love y'all.